energy molecule will enter into the mitochondria electron transport chain. Now pyruvate can also enter into the anaerobic conditions, and at that time they usually make the fermentation process. They make the ethanol or make the lactic acid. We talked about those, right? So after TCA cycle, the net gain NAD, 8 molecules of NADH, 2 molecules of FADH2, 2 molecules of ATP, 8 molecules of NADH and FADH2, 2 molecules of FADH2 will enter into the electron transport chain. There are 6 complexes up there in the mitochondria. Mitochondria has outer membrane of mitochondria, inner membrane of mitochondria, or IMM, OMM, outer membrane of mitochondria, IMM, inner membrane of mitochondria, and matrix is inside. That's a crystal, right? Matrix is inside. So when NADH enters the complex 1, which is called NADH coenzyme Q oxidoreductase, NADH enters in the complex 1, and then it goes to complex 3 in the via transferring the 2 electrons to the UQH2, and complex 3 is known as ubiquinone, right? Coenzyme Q cytochrome C oxidoreductase. And then after that, those 2 electrons ultimately end up with a complex 4, which is called cytochrome C oxidase. Those 2 electrons from complex 4 will take 2 molecules, 2 H plus from the matrix, plus oxygen. That's our aerobic condition, oxygen, 1 atom of oxygen will make the water molecule. And as it goes from complex 1, 3, 4, it will form 4 plus 4 plus 2 protons, so 10 protons. And these 10 protons and the FADH2 enter into complex 2, which is known as succinate coenzyme Q oxidoreductase. Those 2 electrons will go to complex 3, and ultimately those 2 electrons will transfer to complex 4. So one molecule of FADH2 generates 4 plus 2, 6 H plus, NADH 10 H plus, and FADH2 6 H plus. So far so good, right? Now, because of these protons are coming from the matrix to the IMS, intramembrane space of the mitochondria, there will be a proton gradient, low pH in the IMS and high pH in the matrix, and it is lethal to the mitochondria. And cells could die, mitochondria will die, so cells can die. To prevent from this damage or lethal effect of the proton gradient, ATP synthase will take those protons and pass it to the matrix, because nothing can pass through the lipid bilayer, right? It's a hydrophobic core. Therefore, and every 3.7 protons are passing through from via the stator A from the IMS to the matrix, we get one molecule of ADP plus PI combined to make ATP. One molecule of ATP generated from ADP and PI. Then this ADP and PI must enter into the mitochondria in the matrix area through the complex called complex 6, or it's called ATP-ADP translocase. So it basically puts the ADP and PI in the matrix and export the ATP to the cytoplasm. So that's a function of the complex 6, right? All right, so that's super so good, right? Those are all questions will be there from those. And then the ATP, once it comes to cytoplasm, it will hydrolyze to give the energy. ATP is a chemical molecule, it's a chemical. Once it is hydrolyzed, it gives them ADP and PI. Hydrolyzed means ATP plus H2O, ADP and PI. Now, who can tell me how much energy is liberated? How much energy is liberated from one molecule of ATP? Anyone? How much energy?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
When you were saying the ATP, it goes into the cytoplasm, is that what you said?
Yes, and that's where the hydrolysis will take place. So it will hydrolyze into ADP and PI, and it will generate some energy. How much energy does it generate? from one molecule of ATP, how much energy you can get? Do you know? Yes? It's a minus 50 kJ per mole. Minus 50 kJ per mole. Do you have it or not? You should have it. Minus 50 kJ per mole. And the total energy associated with the glucose, yes?
Can you
yes,
write
Jacob?
Down? Because I'm having trouble understanding. For the one molecule of ATP generates?
One molecule of ATP hydrolysis will generate how much energy?
Yeah, I can't hear your response. It's not coming through correctly on my computer.
Well, can anyone hear me? So one molecule of ATP hydrolysis.
Wait, so did you say one ATP of hydrolysis, or once it hydrolyzes, equals negative 50 kilojoules per mole?
That is correct.
Okay.
Yes, that is correct. Yes, yes. And total energy associated with glucose is minus 12,937 kJ per mole. So the efficiency of the glycolysis is how much? It's a 58%. How do you get it? Because the total number of ATP, now who can tell me, if you start from one molecule of glucose, how many molecules of ATP will you get? What's the net gain? How many molecules of ATP you can get?
32 to 34 ATP.
That is correct. If it takes the saddle one, it's a 32, because the two molecules of NADH from cytoplasm enter into the mitochondria, converting into two molecules of FADH2. And one molecule of NADH makes 2.7 molecules of ATP. And why? Because 10H plus divided by 3.7H plus equal 2.7 molecules of ATP. FADH2, one molecule of FADH2 makes 6 divided by 3.7 equals 1.6 molecules of ATP. So therefore, if they take the shuttle 1, that will generate 32. If it takes the shuttle 2, it will give the 34. So the maximum 34 multiplied by minus 50 is minus 1700. That you divide by total energy associated with the glucose is 29 minus 2937 kJ per mole. Multiplied by 100, that will give you 58% or so. That's a glycolytic efficiency of the glycolysis. Any questions so far? Any questions? But those are the one who will be in the test, because that's the end of the glycolysis. That's basically our end of the glycolysis. End of glycolysis. Yes?
I had a quick question. So
yeah.
I was looking at the result from ATP, and it says ADP plus PI plus energy. What's the PI stand for?
A phosphate.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions? So those are the questions that I have, about 12 questions from the glycolysis up to that point, the metabolism. That includes the glycolysis, TCA cycle, electron transport chain, and amount of ATP you get. I have a 12 questions from that. Any questions?
I have a question. I couldn't tell if you went over this, but will we need to know the assembly of F0 plus F1 subunits?
Yeah, just for the reading purposes. Yeah.
So it won't be tested, but we should just know it for learning.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you should know. You should know how the protons are coming from the IMS to the matrix via the stator. A is a stator that has the two tunnels, upper tunnels and lower tunnels. And from the lower tunnels, every 3.7 H plus coming through makes one molecule of ATP. From one molecule of ADP and PI. Yeah, that much you should know. It's okay?
Can you explain what her question was again?
So if you look at the ATP synthase, ATP synthase has two units or subunits called F1 and F0. F0 has the composition AB2, C8 to 15, and B subunit, and the F1 subunit has alpha 2, alpha 3, beta 3, gamma, delta, eta. So she was asking, the assembly, that's assembly. When they assemble together, ape 0 and ape 1, they make the whole complex. And in the complex, the stator is the A, and rotor is a gamma delta ETR subunits. They started rotating back and forth, and pumping the proton from the IMS to the matrix. So that's why she said, whether you should know the assembly of the F0, F1 subunit. In other words, she's asking, should we know the functions of F1, F0 in details? Answer is that you should read it, but you should know how many protons are coming from IMS to the matrix, and how many ATP you get per 3.7 protons. It's okay?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Next one, we want to the lipids. Lipids are two types, simple lipids and complex lipids. And simple, all lipids have a two component, glycerol, simple lipids have two components, glycerol and fatty acids. Fatty acids are two types, saturated and unsaturated. Unsaturated is the double bond. And that double bond is always cis double bond. You can also have a trans fatty acid, trans double bond, but that is very unhealthy. Trans fatty acids are very unhealthy in our health, in animal system, especially the human. The unsaturated fatty acid, the trans fatty acid, can make cholesterol level high, LDL level high. It can lead to atherosclerosis, stroke, etc., etc. So trans fatty acid is bad, and cis fatty acid is okay. It's a healthy. So that's the fatty acids. And fatty acids are usually start from a C2L. The lauric acid is a C2L colon 0, because it's a saturated fatty acid. Myristic acid is C14 colon 0. And stearic acid, palmitic acid is C16 colon 0. And stearic acid is C18 colon 0. So if you combine, if you take the glycerol, which is CH2OH, CHOH, CH2OH, it's a 3-hydroxyl group, and that will take 3-carboxyl group from the fatty acids, maybe the same or different, to make a triester, or it's called triglyceride. Triglyceride concentration is we have a certain concentration of triglycerides in the blood. If you have too much, it is very unhealthy. Triglycerides is also known as fat in the blood. Usually within the 200 is okay. More than 200 and above, usually above 200 is unhealthy, all right? So that's a triglycerides. And triglycerides are named accordingly, depending on the carbon number 1, which fatty acid is there, carbon number 2, 3, 4, 3. For example, if carbon number has lauric acid, then it's called lauryl, 1 lauryl, 2, let's say myristic acid, myristyl, and 3 stearic acid, so stearoyl triglyceride. That's the name, how to name it. Complex lipid has more component. It is also the glycerol. First carbon glycerol, hydroxyl group of the first hydroxyl group of the carbon number 1, CH2OH, makes the esterification reaction to the stearic acid. So first one is stearic acid always. It's a saturated fatty acid. Second one is oleic acid, which is unsaturated fatty acid, C18 colon 1, one double bond at the location, carbon number 9 and 10. Third hydroxyl group of the glycerol makes the esterification reaction with the phosphate, with the phosphoric acid. And then the phosphoric acid makes the esterification reaction with a compound we designed as an X group. X is the variable. And based on the name of the X, we basically name the lipid, right? So the composition of the complex lipid, glycerol, saturated fatty acid, stearic acid, unsaturated fatty acid, oleic acid, phosphate group, and an X group, or X is the molecule, the hydroxyl group, and we name the lipid accordingly. So if the X group is a choline, then the name of the complex lipid is phosphatidyl choline. And if the X group is a serine, it is called phosphatidyl serine. Now who can tell me, where do we see the phosphatidyl choline and phosphatidyl serine? Where do you see this? Phosphatidyl serine, phosphatidyl choline, and phosphatidyl serine.
inner lipid bilayers?
Yes. So phosphatidylcholine is the outer lipid of the cell membrane. And phosphatidylserine is the inner lipid of the cell membrane. That is correct. And why the inner lipid, outer lipid? Because when you take the complex lipid, it has a head group, which is a phosphate group, negative charge, and it is a two tail. It is a tail group. Tail group consists of saturated fatty acid and unsaturated fatty acid. They're hydrophobic, they hate water. Once you add the water to this, they create lipid bilayer, and which is the most important part of the cell membrane. And therefore, cell membrane has two layers, lipid bilayer, right? Bi means two layers. One is the inner lipid, that's close to the cytoplasm, inside the cytoplasm, and outer lipid, which is outside the cell. And in between, if you want to pass something from those, then one must have a channels and tunnels or carriers. Remember, channels and tunnels are carrier, right? They consist of the membrane proteins. And channels or tunnels are carrier are usually four types. Usually four, there are more than that, but at least four of them. One is a cationic channel, anionic channel, neutral channel. And neutral channel basically passes those sugars, right? And some amino acids too. And the last one is a carrier. Carrier basically transport drugs. When you take the medicine, the antibiotics and etc. from outside to inside. When you are not taking medicine, the normal function of the carriers, usually they transport the toxic chemicals, the toxic substances from the cytoplasm to outside the cell. So those are the you should know that, right? So channels and tunnels consist of proteins, and those are the function of those channels and tunnels. Any questions? So that's basically up to the lipid that you should know. The lipid pumps from the portion of the thing that we talked about, that is the thing that you must know. Any questions? If not, the protein consists, the building block of the proteins is the amino acids. And general formula of the amino acid is RCHNH2COOH, right? And that C, if R is not hydrogen, then that C is a chiral center, optically active, and it has a configuration, L configuration. All naturally occurring amino acids have L configuration. RCHNH2COH, it doesn't exist as it is, because the NH2 group can accept the proton from the carboxyl group COOH, and therefore it makes RCHNH3 positive COO negative. It's called zuteran. And R is the variable. Based on the R group, there are 22 amino acids we know so far. And among those 22, 21 of them are optically active, because if R is hydrogen, which is known as glycine, right? So CH2, NH3 positive and CO negative, it's called glycine. And therefore this carbon, this glycine is optically inactive, or a chiral center. So then we classified based on the R groups. Amino acid could be classified into four different groups. If the R group consists of a alkyl groups, like a CH3, isopropyl group, etc., then those are called hydrophobic amino acids. Hydrophobic amino acid. And if it is a CH3, the name of the amino acid is alanine. Abbreviated as ALA or A. If R group is the CH3OH, that's a serine, and SER is a three-letter abbreviation. If R group is the CH2CH2COOH, it's called glutamic acid. If it is CH2COH, it's an aspartic acid. If it is CH2CH2COH, is a glutamic acid. So the first one, if it's hydrophobic, we call those hydrophobic amino acids. Second one is a serine, we call hydrophilic amino acids. Those are neutral amino acids. They're hydrophilic, they love water, hydrophobic hates water. And then the next class is the acidic amino acid. There are two types, glutamic acid, there are two of them, acetic acid, glutamic acid and aspartic acid. And there are eight each of hydrophobic amino acids and hydrophilic amino acid or neutral amino acids. There are last group of amino acids is the basic amino acids. There are three amino acids up there. The first one is lysine. That has the R group is CH2, four of them, NH2. And it also have a another amino acid called arginine, histidine, but I give the structure of the lysine only. So you should know that, right? And that's basically the amino acid structures. An amino acid structure is a tetrahedral, right? And bond angle is 109.5. And then that's basically the amino acid structure and basically the function, the structure and function. Then function, or another function of those amino acids is to make proteins through the polymerization reactions. And in the during the polymerization reactions, the hydroxyl group from the first amino acid, the hydroxyl group of the carboxylic group of the first amino acid takes the hydrogen from NH2 group from the second amino acid and make the dehydration reaction, right? And that makes the peptide bond. And peptide bond is designated as C, bond C, double bond O, NH. And all the amino acids during the polymerization reaction, all the amino acids are linked via peptide bonds, very similar to amide bond, peptide bonds, right? And the number of amino acid in the polymer or polypeptide, that tells you whether it is a oligopeptide, it is a dipeptide, tripeptide, tetrapeptide, oligopeptide, or protein. So when it is a dipeptide, one such example I gave you, aspartame has a D, remember, aspartame has a L-ASP and L-phenylalanine, make the peptide bond. It cannot have any other combination. If you have a D aspartic acid, L-phenylalanine, or L-aspartic acid, D-phenylalanine, or both of them are D, they're bitter in test. And aspartame, the dipeptide, is very useful to our health. Basically, it's a sugar substitute. It's called aspartame. It is about 200 times sweeter than the table sugar. When n equal 20 or more, it's called oligopeptide. When n equal greater than 50, we call protein. N is the number of amino acid, right? Amino acid polymerized. And those proteins could be many different types based upon their function. One such protein, we talked about the membrane protein. They make a channels, tunnels, pumps, carriers. Those are cationic channel, anionic channel, etc., etc. There are other type of proteins are also known as transport proteins. They transfer something. There are quite a few examples of that. One such example, vital to our life, is the hemoglobin. Hemoglobin has a 2 polypeptide, alpha 2, beta 2. So it binds to 4 molecules of oxygen. And the way they bind, inside the hemoglobin, we have iron 2 plus. Iron 2 plus, once it binds to oxygen, it becomes iron 3 plus. And that's why it's a deep red. The 3 plus iron is very deep red, red color. Iron 2 plus is a greenish color. Basically, it's a bluish, blue to green color. It's a blue. So when the hemoglobin binds to oxygen and heart in the lungs, and then heart pump it out to all over the body, goes on the top of the cell, individual cells, and delivers the oxygen and become Fe2+. That is the blue color coming from the vein, and arteries are carrying the deep red blood, right? So hemoglobin, and we also talked about the other transport proteins like LDL, low density lipoprotein, high density lipoprotein, VLDL, etc., etc. The storage protein includes the myoglobin. It binds to 1 molecule of oxygen present in the muscles, and it stores oxygen when it is exercised. You use that oxygen. Another large class of proteins is enzymes. Enzymes are catalysts, and the catalyst usually they perform the chemical reaction, biochemical reactions, and they do not change the structure before the reaction and after the reaction. They lower the activation energy. Activation energy is the energy required to put those substances, reactants, into the transition state when they make the products, right? So enzymes lower the activation energy, and therefore they accelerate or speed up the rate of the reactions. And all those enzymes, there are six classes of enzymes, right? Remember, there are six classes of enzymes. And those enzymes have a three characteristics, important characteristics. One such characteristics is the catalytic power, CP. CP, catalytic power, is defined as the ratio of the rate of the enzymatic reactions, rate of the reaction with the enzyme, divided by rate of the reaction without enzyme. Without enzyme. So that's the CP. And CP values, it can go up to 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 28 order of magnitude. Very high power of those enzymes. One such example that we gave you, the urease, right? Urease, when you eat the protein food, we generate plenty of urea. Urea used as a fertilizer is good for the plants, but toxic for our cells inside our body. So therefore, it has to be degraded into through the enzyme called urease. And the rate of the reaction with urease, rate of the degradation of urea with urease, is a 3 times 10 to the 4 per second. And rate of the degradation of urea without urease is 3 times 10 to the -10. If you take the ratio, you get about 10 to the 14 order of magnitude. In other words, it's very, very high powerful enzyme, right? So that's basically the enzymes, the function of those enzymes. One such the CP. Another characteristic of the enzymes is the substrate specificity.
Dr. Dada?
Yeah?
I just had a quick question. You kind of broke up. What is the rate of reaction with the enzyme, with the urea example you just gave?
So rate of the enzyme with enzyme is very, very fast because it lowers the activation energy, therefore accelerates the rate of the reaction.
So do we need to know the exact number?
Is it your question?
Kind of.
No, you don't need to do the exact number. If I ask, I'll give you the number. You should know what the CP means. CP is the catalytic power, right? It's a catalytic power. Yes or no?
Yep.
Yes. Yeah? Okay. All right. So the next characteristic of the enzymes is the substrate specificity. It can bind only one substrate and not anything else. That's the substrate specificity. For example, if you have the hexokinase or glucokinase, that will bind the glucose only, not anything else. So they basically have the substrate specificity. The third characteristics is the regulation. The enzymatic activity, all the enzymatic activity inside our body are basically regulated by the pH, must be maintained, right? 7.4 inside the cell, or 1.8 to 2 inside our gut, inside our stomach, because very, very low pH, or some other places it can also be 5.5, for example, lysozyme. So the pH is very important to maintain the function of the enzymes. Likewise, salt concentration, the K plus, potassium plus, must be 100 millimolar inside the cell, so that it must maintain the appropriate cell salt concentration. Likewise, the temperature, 37 degree, is also important to maintain the temperature of our body. And there are some others, the other factors of that too, we do not talk about much, right? All right, so these proteins, after the synthesis, they basically fold into secondary structure, tertiary structures, and that's a functional. Who can tell me what are the secondary structures do you know? What are the secondary structures that basically we talked about? What type of secondary structures? Anyone?
So
what are the secondary structures of the protein?
There's the alpha helixes and then there's the beta sheets.
And?
Beta-torn. Yeah, the beta.
Yes, those are three different types of secondary structures. And those secondary structures, once they combine with the weak interactions, they fold into three-dimensional structures. And the weak interactions include, but not limited to, include hydrogen bonding, London dispersion force, dipole-dipole, ionic interactions, and hydrophobic interactions. Yes, Riley, what's up?
Can you repeat those three? Sorry.
Alpha helices, beta sheets, and beta torn. Those are secondary structures. When they combine with weak interactions like hydrogen bonding, hydrogen bonds, London dispersion force, dipole-dipole interactions, hydrophobic interactions, and ionic interactions, they fold into three-dimensional structure. Yeah. It's okay? All right. That's basically the enzymes or proteins that we talked about so far. Nothing much there after that. So that will end up probably question number 34 or something like that. Okay? All right. The next one that we talked about, the nucleic acids. Yes? So nucleic acids are two types. It's a DNA and RNA. And they have a three different components. The building blocks of the nucleic acids are the nucleotides. Nucleotide, T. Nucleotides have three components. Has a base, not the alkali, it's a base. Adenine, guanine, cytosine, thymine, and uracil. The five different bases are there. And those bases, when combined with sugar, two types of sugar, right? D-ribose and deoxyribose. And then when those two, bases combined with sugar, make the nucleosides. For example, adenine, if you add the adenine to the D-ribose, then it'll be adenosine. Adenine is adenosine, right? Adenosine. So this basically changes the number. Guanine, guanosine. Cytosine, cytidine. Thymine, thymidine. Uracil, uridine. Once they bind to sugar. Once they bind, when the nucleosides bind to the phosphate, depending on how many phosphate, they become the nucleotide, nucleotides. For example, AMP, adenosine monophosphate, only one phosphate there. Adenosine diphosphate, ADP. Adenosine triphosphate, ATP. And this basically, they have a ribose, right? And this present in RNA. When it is DNA, the ribose, the sugar is deoxyribose because the carbon number 2 has a hydrogen instead of OH group, right? Instead of O. So that's called deoxy, oxygen is removed. And therefore the name, so the nucleotides present in DNA is DATP, DGTP, DCTP, and DTTP. And RNA has ATP, GTP, CTP, and UTP. So that's the difference between the RNA and DNA. The subtle difference between RNA and DNA and RNA, DNA has a deoxyribose and T, thymine. RNA has D ribose and uracil. Other three bases are the same. And those four, five bases could be classified into two groups. And those are called purines. Adenine and guanine are belongs to the purine family. And cytosine, thymine, and uracil belongs to the pyrimidine family. Pyrimidine family. Yes or no? All right. So that's basically the nucleotides. The nucleotides, when the one of the most important functions of the nucleotides is the polymerization reaction. When you have a N, lowercase n, number of NTPs, DNTPs, for example, N number of DNTPs, and that capital N is the A, C, G, or T, and that uses the magnesium 2+ and the DNA polymerase to make the DNA, right? A single-stranded DNA. And the direction of the DNA is 5' to 3', and the structure, when they combine with another strand, it make a double-stranded DNA. So DNA is always double-stranded. And that double-stranded structure is a helical, so this is double-stranded and helical, and it is antiparallel. Those two strands in the double-stranded DNA, one is the direction is 5' to 3', other one is 3' to 5'. So it's a double-stranded DNA, and the structure of DNA is a double-stranded, helical, and antiparallel. In the helical structure, the double-stranded DNA, the base pairing is A, adenine base pair, makes two hydrogen bonds, the T. C makes three hydrogen bonds, the G, and vice versa. So those are the hydrogen bonds, not double bond, triple bond, right? And once they make, they stabilize the double-stranded DNA, and that's because the secondary structure of the DNA is functional. It's functional. And that's a polymerase reaction. And this polymerase reaction takes place during the replication of the DNA. When one cell divides into two, the whole chromosome, there's a 23 pairs of chromosomes in our human body, will be converted to 46 pairs of chromosomes. They divide into two cells, so one cell become two. That's a replication, DNA replication. And that's the reaction takes place, right? NTPs, DNTPs, plus DNA polymerase, magnesium, and it duplicates one copy of DNA to two copies of DNA. DNA can also, when the transcribe, after the transcription, it makes the RNA. And the polymerase reaction of the RNA is the NTPs, right? N number of NTPs, lowercase n number of NTPs. And here is capital N is A, C, G, and U, not T, right? Plus magnesium 2 plus, plus RNA polymerase. And that basically copies the template strand from the DNA to make the RNA, all right? So RNA reaction is NTP, N NTPs plus RNA polymerase plus magnesium to make RNA. RNA is a single stranded, and the direction of the RNA is also 5 prime to 3 prime. And that single strand DNA could be folding into stem loop structures, and ultimately with a pseudo knot, with a long range interaction, make a tertiary structure of the RNA. All right. So, and this transcription usually takes place to make to three different types of RNA: mRNA, messenger RNA, transfer RNA, tRNA, and ribosomal RNA. Messenger RNA has a codon, codes for amino acids. It has a codon, triplet codons. tRNA brings the amino acid, mRNA and codon, and tRNA has anticodon. They interact to transport that, to decode the codon from the mRNA to amino acids. And ribosome RNA, which has a bunch of proteins, it makes the ribosome. Ribosome acts like a platform. So once you have a platform, mRNA goes inside, tRNA brings the amino acids, two of them together at the same time, they recognize the codons and make the peptide bond, and it continues like this. When a second peptide bond is made, first tRNA is out from the dome, from the ribosome, and it's continued like this way. And you can make n number of amino acids would become polymerized into proteins, right? And so the central dogma, is the DNA during the replication makes RNA, DNA during transcription make RNA. Three different types of RNA, right? mRNA, tRNA, and rRNA. And the RNA, mRNA translate into proteins, So that's old central dogma. The new central dogma is that DNA makes DNA, DNA makes RNA, and RNA makes protein. And RNA can also make DNA. It's reversible. All right? Now, who can tell me how many types of DNA do we have? How many types of DNA we know? How many types of DNA we know?
Is it three?
Yep. What are they? A type DNA, B type DNA, and Z. And which DNA we have? Which one is the naturally occurring DNA?
B DNA.
That is correct. That is absolutely right. All right, very good. So that's basically, and all we talked about all organisms have three different types of RNA, mRNA, tRNA, and ribosomal RNA. And we also talked about the central dogma. Yes, Gabriel.
Can you repeat the types of DNA were real quick?
A DNA, B DNA, and Z. Z for zebra, Z DNA.
Great, thank you.
Any other questions? You're welcome. Then we talked about the that's basically the new new topics. Then old topics include, I'll ask you one basic questions: the location of the protons, neutron, and the location of the electrons. So basic principle of the atomic structure is the protons and neutrons are in the nucleus. Proton has a positive charge, neutron has a negative charge. Electrons are the neutrons have a neutral charge, no charge. Electrons have a negative charge. And due to the positive negative attraction, electrons are spinning around the nucleus, right? And then we talked about the elements present in our body. Can give you some example? which element or which ion present in a thyroid? Anyone tell me? Which ion present in a thyroid? Yeah?
Is it
which ion present in a thyroid? Iodide, I minus present in iodide. Calcium present in our bone. Iron 2 plus, 3 plus present in the red blood cells. Sodium, potassium pump present in all cells because they pump the sodium, potassium, right? 3 sodium comes out and 2 potassium gets in, right? That's a function of the sodium, potassium pump, also ATPase, right? All right, the next one, when metals makes the cation, anion and non-metals makes the anion. When cation and anion combine, they create what? Cations and anion combine, they make?
Salts.
They make ionic compounds. So that ionic compound could be soluble or insoluble, depending on the what type of compounds made. That's right. And what is the basic principle of making covalent compounds? The basic principle of making covalent compounds. Basic principle of making covalent compounds. Anyone? So non-metals plus non-metals make a covalent compound. Non-metals plus metalloids, they make a covalent compound. Metalloids plus metalloids, they can also make a covalent compound. Covalent compounds is making sharing a pair of electrons. It's a very strong bond, because it makes the spin pairing, north pole, south pole, south pole, north pole. So they're very strong bond. They create a very strong bond. All right. Then we talked about some properties of those covalent compounds, like gases. How many gas laws do you know that applies to our body? How many gas laws do you know? So Boyle's law is operating in our lungs, right? And Gay-Lussac's law, we use it to sterilize to kill the bacteria, germs in our surgical equipments and surgical stuff, right? All right, then in our body, how many buffer system do you know? I have two buffer system, right? One is a closed system, and one is open system. Closed system consists of the phosphate, H2PO4 minus, and H2PO4 minus. And open system has the dissolved carbon dioxide and bicarbonate, right? Bicarbonate buffer. And then we also talked about the principle of dialysis. Now, tell me which organ in our body does the dialysis?
The kidney.
Kidney is a pair of kidneys, basically, that filters the toxic chemicals or toxic chemicals coming from the metabolic processes. That is correct. And then we also talked about the application of disaccharides, monosaccharides, and polysaccharides, and which saccharide is present in the antibiotics? Does anyone know? Which saccharide is present in our antibiotics? Modified oligosaccharides are present in our antibiotics, right? And what are the applications of alcohols? Does anyone know applications of alcohols? What are the applications of alcohols?
Disinfectants.
And what are the applications of amines? It's a drug. It's an analgesic. Meaning painkillers. It's a painkillers. And you know the applications of aldehydes, ketones, alcohols, and carboxylic acids, etc. So that's basically I have about, let's say, I'll have probably 58 questions, so 56 to 58, 150 points plus 10 points bonus, and that is the our test. That's the final exam. Yes, any questions? Yes, Riley? Yes?
Can you repeat the Boyle's law application?
So the Boyle's law is in our lungs. It's a P1, V1 equal to V2. Temperature remains the same, and the volume and pressure are variables as a lung function. We expand and contracts. So gas volume, air gets in and then gets out, depending on expansion and contraction. So Boyle's law. And Gay-Lussac's law is to kill the bacteria germs from us during the sterilization of the surgical things. Yes, Jamie, what's up?
I was just wondering, how long do we have for the exam?
Your exam is on Friday, right? Yes, your exam is Friday. Yes,
yeah,
right?
But
is it right?
How much?
Your exam is Friday.
Yeah, but how much time do we have to take
it? Starts 2 hours and 15 minutes. 2 hours and 15 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
Could you go over the...
It starts 10:45. Buffers are two types of buffer we have. One is called open system. Open system has the... Yes, Jacob, I'm coming to you. Open system has a dissolved carbon dioxide and bicarbonate. And the closed system has the HPO4 2- and H2PO4. And that makes the pH. Yes, Jacob first. Jacob, and I'll come to you, Alex. Jacob, what do you question? What question do you have?
How many questions are on the final exam?
It's about 58 or so.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes, Alex, ask question. What is the question, Alex?
What elements in the thyroid?
Iodine, I minus, iodine. Yeah, iodine.
You said
another
I question? Minus? You said I minus?
Yeah,
or...
iodine.
Okay.
Yeah, iodide. Remember sodium iodide, potassium iodide? Yes. Yes, Nicole. Question.
Is it going to be sent through Google Forms again? Like, you'll email it to us?
Say it again, Nicole. Yeah, what's up?
Are you going to, like, email it to us through Google Forms to take again?
It'll be exactly the same way. So I'll send you the exam and the Google form attached to the link.
Okay.
So exactly the same format, same thing. You must have procedures, you must have followed the same principles, same rules. And I'll send it the exam probably, let's say, 10:15. So I might send it about 10 o'clock or so around that time. And the SS students will get 1 hour early. So I'll send to them probably around 9 o'clock or so. If they need more time, just let me know. But I think I can give you as much time you want, because that's why I'm obligated to give them at least 2 hours minimum if they want. So I do not want to send you the test at 8 o'clock in the morning, but if you want to, but I can send it around, say, 9 o'clock or 9:15, and it can take as long as you just 3 hours or whatever, whatever you want. All right, that's for the SAS students. You're welcome. Anybody else the question? Yes, Ali. Yes, Ali. Ali, what question do you have? Yes, I'm listening. Ali, can you hear me? Ali, can you hear me? All right. Looks like Ali left. Yes, Andrea. What question? What's up?
So you say you're still doing office hours during next week?
Yeah. I'll have office hours until Tuesday. Sure. I'll have office hours. Same time, same thing, no thing.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Nicole, what's up?
Hi, do you know when you're gonna put in your the next attendance points?
Which one? Sorry, which one is that?
The attendance points. When do you think you're those will be in the grade book?
I will work on this weekend.
Okay, great.
I'll work on this weekend and see how. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any other question? You're welcome. Anybody else has a question? Yes, Katie.
Okay.
What question do you have?